meet our new sportscaster, Kelly Michelle.
Hello there. Well, listen, I'm honored to meet you as an old sports announcer myself. You kind of make me feel I was a little late starting.
She's on from 7 to 8 every morning in Boston.
Well, that's wonderful.
Isn't that great?
Just wonderful.
Morning,
it's a for the self.
National Lines of Business.
Well,
you had us here last year on the business people. Yeah. Appreciate it.
Is that radio or TV?
Radio.
Mr. President, Fred Mann for ABC Radio.
Hi.
Nice to meet you, sir.
Nice to see
pleasure.
You.
Pleasure.
Mr. President,
how are you, sir? Great to see you.
Nice to see you.
Pleasure. Wouldn't miss it.
Don't judge me, Mr. President, and not October.
That's right. Nice to see you.
Mr. President, Warner Wolf on WCBS. Nice to meet you.
So wait before you all have to go out there and ahead of me, should we get a group picture here?
Perfect.
Thank you, sir.
This would be a place. Tell a story here about my own sports announcing days that was a wrestler in those days named Ed Strangler Lewis. And I was interviewing him on the station. And he came in, and usually I'd ask if they had any particular questions they'd like me to ask, and so I asked him, and he said, yeah. He said, you might ask me why wrestlers' necks are so thick. So we got on the air, and he said, by the way, answer was, well, if you tell me why announcers' heads are so thick, I'll go.
Remember that, Kelly, if anybody asked.
Well, that must be a whole hour.
No, just it's a minute and a half, and they play it throughout the
show. Oh, I see. Well, I think that's great.
She's decided the Celtics are going to win the playoffs.
Yeah.
I wonder how that.
Radio was really, I always felt so wonderful about that. And then I don't know this story. I was broadcasting a Chicago Cubs Cardinals game once, ninth inning, all tied up. Fizzy Dean out of the mound. And I was doing a telegraphic report. I wasn't at the ballpark looking at it. The fellow on the other side of the window was hearing the Morse code and tapping out, and it'd come through to me and it'd say S1C. Well, I couldn't sell any Wheaties yelling S1C, so I'd say it's a call strike, break over the outside corner, and so on, describe what was going on. And I saw him start to type at that particular point in the game, and he started shaking his head when I started. Dizzy Dean getting his sign, comes out of the windup. I haven't got the paper yet. And comes through to me and says, the wire has gone dead. Got a ball on the way to the plate. So I decided, those days there were a half a dozen that were broadcast in the same game. So in those days, I wasn't going to say, we'll have a brief interlude of transcribed music, lose the audience. So I decided to take a chance. I had him foul one off. And then I had him foul another one. And I described the two kids back at third base that got to fight over the ball. I found one that just missed being a home run by a foot. Well, pretty soon I'm really beginning to sweat because I think I am setting a world's record for a man hitting successive I don't know how many minutes. I really had him up there. That played an awful long time. And all of a sudden, Curly on the other side started to type. And I waited. When the thing came through to me, I started to giggle, I could hardly talk. Said Jurgis popped out of the first ball pit.
President, I think we're ready on the side.
Ready? Well, yes. You're going out first and Bill, you're
yeah. Yes. President, Secretary, Brock will remain inside. Everyone else will go outside and you're going to be escorted.
WGNs, which is a satellite station.
They're going to take your places right inside.
In fact, that's Virginia, yes.
Mr. President, I want to go over the scenario, if I could, real quick. Ben, you're going to join them outside in just a second, but since you have remarks at the end, I just want to go over this. When we go out, Mr. President, you'll be announced with Secretary Brock. secretary will go directly to the podium and introduce you. You're going to stand on the secretary's toe mark to the right of the podium during his introduction, and then you'll basically flip-flop, give your remarks. And when you finish your remarks, you're going to flip-flop with Vin Scully, who's going to be standing to your left. So you're going to stand on Secretary Brock's toe mark when you first go out, which is to the right, and then you're going to speak. And when you finish, you step to your left. And then Vin is going to go to the podium and present you with a golden microphone. And it's important that when you actually hand it to the president, that you do it to the left of the podium, because the podium is so big that a lot of times it blocks right out the presentation. So we need to step to the left. And after the presentation, that does it. You'll make thank you remarks, and that'll conclude the ceremony. So we're going to go ahead and have you step out ahead of time here, Ben. We'll be right behind you.
Nice to see you again, sir.
Hey, good to see you.
Tom said he did not, I was just going to make some remarks and then step back and not introduce the president since he didn't need an introduction.
Okay, however, whatever, that's fine. That's fine, Mr. Secretary.
Really turn.
Well, no, that's good, because then I don't have any to introduce him. He just steps up without being introduced.
That's
you'll just switch places. The president will go to the podium, and you'll stand where the president was standing while you make your
report. I was considered by thanking him for their support. That's really what we're all right about. These sports guys are just going to do a job for us. There'll be a lot of people.
Thank you very much. And I just welcome you and express my pleasure and appreciation that you're coming. There are over, really sick more than anything else. That first opportunity to get a job skill so that they can acquire the pride and self-respect that comes from human productivity.
The support that you have given this and similar programs to give our young people that first meaningful job experience and the opportunity to become prideful, productive members.
Daily, on her radio station, Kelly is sports announcer. These past couple of months, as the trees have begun to leaf out and the flowers to blossom, spring has come to America, an America that is in good economic health. Jobs have been created in more than 200,000 last month alone. As summer follows spring, inflation will remain low, and our young people who will find it hardest to get work will be the ones who need jobs the most. To them, a summer job means a chance to escape poverty and disadvantage, a chance to get the work for foundation, house construction. I have to confess that pick and shovel work got a little heavy at times. One day I was hard at it, swinging a pick.
Possible for me to get it if certain laws in place today had been in effect back then. Maybe in our effort to do good, maybe we hadn't been as successful as we thought we were when we passed some of those laws. Under the current minimum wage law, facilities, personnel,
Mr. President, Mr. Secretary, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I play a very small and modest part here. Frankly, I am well over my head. It's a long way from a baseball dugout to the Rose Garden, but I'm honored to be here. All of us in the American Sports Broadcasters Association of America realize the American Sportscasters of America will remind the youth to, if they want to, come to us for counsel, for advice. We even have a scorecard so that they might check off the right things to do in looking for a job. So that's why I'm here, to join with the National Alliance of Business to salute you folks and also to make this presentation. It could very well be a belated gold mic for his work at the Drake Relays, or it could even be for his outstanding work broadcasting for the Chicago Cubs, but it's not. Instead, this award today is from the American Sports Broadcasters Association of America to the President of the United States, the Honorable Ronald Reagan, for his constant efforts on behalf of the youth of America. Sir, it is yours.
Well, I can't help or can't find the words to thank the American Sportscasters Association I can't say one thing, Ben. You said it was a long way from the dugout to the Rose Garden. How do you think I feel?
Thank you for your kind words the other night. That kind of made my evening. Appreciate that.
Right.
Mr. President, nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Well, come in. Hi.
Mr. President.
Good. I had a big weekend with mail. Every once in a while, Ann Higgins over there at the mail department. 1,380,000 came in from April 2nd to May 16th. But then she picks out some strange samples that she thinks I might want to see and sends them over to a big packet of them. And I can't resist. I answer them all myself and send them back to her. And I got one day, son, a fellow telling about all the troubles he'd had economically and everything. And not a murmur out of him. And he's back at it and doing fine now and so forth. And he wants more cuts in government spending, and he doesn't believe in all those programs. And if you're wondering what that means, he coined this. It's a bumper sticker. And what it means, got two meanings. There's the first one and now a follow-up. What that stands for is liberal appropriations made our overextended budget. And the second one means, let's all manage our own business. That's his lamoon. Well, it's taken us a while to get around to having this meeting. I'm glad we're here and looking forward to it. Come in, Pat.
Hello, Pat.
Appreciate all the help. And sometimes I see you every once in a while. I get up the dressing room there and taking off my clothes after work and turn on and see someone who's speaking to the empty congressional chamber.
But to at least 250,000 Americans.
Yes.
Yeah, I know. A gift from my father-in-law to give to you.
I understand.
It was presented, I tried to present it a year and a half ago when you and the Pope met, but it's been a little hard getting it to you, but now we've got it here. Thanks to Henry, if you would have been. So if I may. This is the gun case. This is from Vinita, Alaska, from Dan Frank, with my father-in-law. And that is for one of your weapons. Looking good here. And this is for Nancy. This is a baby belt. And the way it works is she slips it over the shoulder. Nancy's not going to have a baby, but maybe one of her daughters or granddaughters will. Slips it over your shoulders, and they tie it, and the baby's held like this on her back. So
yes. Well, it goes under the baby's arm?
Yeah, over the, like, I'm a little large for this, but it goes like this. They get pulled across the baby back in. That's the way the whole one, that's what the Navy's doing.
For heaven's sakes.
But she saw that when you were up in Alaska. The Pope had one made for the his robe.
Yeah.
And it was presented by a lady up there, Doris Sloan.
This
and
is
so
fantastic.
My father-in-law was there and watched you and the Pope, and he said, I'm going to give this to you. It's his gift.
Well, my goodness.
And I'd appreciate it if at the proper time you could autograph a picture for him and send him.
Stand right here for a second.
All right.
Now, I've got two kinds here. I've got one looks kind of like I'm in the office, and then I've got another one. It looks like I'm a Durant.
What did you do that?
These are the ones I prefer.
Yeah. It is the Dan Frank. Thank you for the gun case and the baby belt. Best regards, whatever you would like to write. I can't tell you to do this all the time. very busy up here. Right. Hey, again, we got some more work to do. I know. You will see that there.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you.
It's good to see you.
Thank you. My wife, Joanne.
Nice to see you, Mr. President.
My daughter, Tori.
Hi, how are you, Tori?
And my daughter, Kathy.
Hi, Kathy. How are you? Why don't we get upstairs?
Oh, that would be wonderful.
Wonderful. Come here, Kathy. Come here. You want Dad to hold you? Huh?
Tori, you want to get on the other side of the room?
Yes.
Can you do Burger Cheese, Catherine?
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. President, this is the 250th anniversary of St. Genevieve, Missouri, which is known as the Mother City of the West. It was the first European settlement west of the Mississippi, founded in 1735. It's a great, well-preserved city. There are homes there, approximately 50, that are over 200 years old, and it's considered one of the finest examples of French colonial architecture anywhere in the world. And they're going all out this year for their celebration. You were very kind to send them a written message a month or so ago, but they have had a medal struck. This is 0.999 fine silver, and they want you to have medal number one in commemoration of their 250th anniversary. And here is a certificate of authentication. And Catherine wants you to have that letter.
Oh, this is wonderful. My campaign. You know, it's a great surprise to people in the name west of the Mississippi.
Is that old?
Yes. You know, St. Louis was founded some 30 years later, in fact, and most people don't know that. It's,
please convey my heartfelt thanks to them.
Certainly will, and we're honored that you would see us and accept this.
Now I'll see this other document.
That's from Catherine. She wrote that to you.
Well, thank you very much.
Now, what did you say you were going to...
She would like to give you a hug.
She wants to know she can give you a hug.
President Reagan a hug.
I would like...
Because I know you wanted to do it.
She says she wants to give you a hug. She's a little bashful.
I'd like to have a hug.
Oh, boy. Catherine, you got to let go.
Now, what do you say to President Reagan?
What were you going to tell him?
What were you going to tell him? You what?
She loves you.
Thank you. I was wondering if she wanted me to explain that little squeal that she heard right then.
That's what she was listening to. Okay. And Tori.
Catherine, thank you very much.
Can you say thank you, Mr. President?
She's shy. Now, Tori, what did you want to tell Mr. President?
Your birthday is not the same day.
That's right, February 6th.
Well, that's a good day. Yes. That makes us Aquarius.
I'm gray.
Yes, Catherine, you're three. Mr. President, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Oh, my. She's happy.
She's too happy for you to hold. No. Tori, she's happy for her.
Thank you very much, Tori.
Thank you, Mr. President.
All right. Good to see you. Thanks.
I'll think happy birthday when my birthday comes.
Say bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
President. You're letting us come by.
Well, this is great.
My daughter.
Hello there.
My wife, Ellen.
Nice to see you, Mr. President.
And my son, Jared.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, Greg let us do this.
Well, this is why don't we come in here and get somebody home and this something.
So we probably don't want me to move, or? Want to get that way.
Well, they're
That's pretty good.
All right.
They even got the telly going.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, it's a great pleasure. Thank you for coming down.
I know you're my son is at Sibley Friends School. And told me that your wife went to Sidwell for a small period of time.
Is that true? That's a rumor.
That's true or not. I don't know if that's true or not. Yeah. It says that at some point, you think it was a child, or you think it was Mrs. Reagan?
Maybe it was a child. I
in Washington.
Well, there's a rumor.
Rumors like this in every school.
There's a rumor that your wife went to his school, Sidwell Friends School, which is a Quaker school up in Northwest Washington. Now, and she didn't graduate from there, but went there for.
And then she transferred.
Transferred to somewhere else, but.
Now, I'm wondering.
That was,
because there was a time when Nancy was very small, when her mother was out on the road and she stayed with an aunt and uncle in Bethesda.
Yes, that's the area. We'll do a little historical research and let you know. It wasn't in the scrapbook she got the other day. Check that out.
All right.
Again, thank you very much.
Well, listen,
we appreciate it.
Thank you for a couple of recent votes that I'm grateful for.
You were on the beam of those, and I'll do that again if we get the chance. I assure you.
Right.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Mr. President. Big pleasure.
Nice to meet you, sir.
Nice to see you.
Nice to
meet you. One of these in addition to.
Okay. All right. Mr. President,
how are you? Good. Good to see you.
Listen. Is that one kind of
yes, that'd be terrific.
Fire.
How are you coming on the Badger form?
Well, I've got my fingers crossed here. We're pretty close. We're still
good.
Now,
how did you do this? You fellas are the experts.
There and four more.
That's good. That's good. You got to go Canadian maple leaf.
No, this is, that's the French.
Well, that's French. Oh, great.
This is from St. Genevieve, Missouri. The congressman just came in. This is silver commemorating.
I should have brought you a sunshine. We met those in Idaho, too.
Well, this is their 250th anniversary. I never knew there was anything west of the Mississippi 250 years ago. But the French started, that's the oldest town west of the Mississippi that was created there. And he said they've got 40 or 50 homes that are 200 years old in that town, St. Genevieve. So this is their celebration claim.
Get your tax reform bill as close to Kemp and Cassidy as you can get.
Well, we've been going through a lot of things. We disagree with him on the 30 versus the 35.
Well, he's got a 24 now on individual rates. And they kept oil and gas and minerals in. The way current law is. See, now the Treasury will tell you that the revenues cost $282 billion, but they don't know how much it'll cost.
They
have no idea.
Well, he hasn't been able to give us some substantiation for some of the things that he has in there. But we're pretty determined that the 1525.
And on some, if I can help you on it, if there's any of those congressmen that you need some help on, tell your people to have me call them. I mean, I've been calling some of them to not cut the fence anymore because this whole thing will go sky high. You know, interest rates are going down every day right now.
Yep.
And I think it's a result of people are positive. They think we're making headway on the budget.
I think so, too.
And they're feeling good about it. But if this whole thing blows up, if they cut defense, you know, you're going to have you and a whole bunch of other people upset about it. The thing will blow up and then wham, there it goes.
Well,
I got a plan for you on Nicaragua, but I hesitate to bring it up today.
Well, I know we haven't been there.
No, you don't. I told Bill Casey out here, he said, give it to the commander-in-chief. You know, in a nutshell, if you could go in there and hit it really hard for about 2 days with our air power, land some troops, take out the main part of their army, and then leave a lot of supplies there and just pull all of our people out, you could turn them all over the Contras, and you'd be the biggest hero world, and you wouldn't have to ask Congress for the money. You could give them $25 million worth of equipment. Think about it. Yeah. Just think about the possibility.
Yeah. But Steve, I have to tell you, my own business down there with the other countries, even though they want us our help and they want us to straighten this out, you'd be surprised they would want to.
Well, you wouldn't leave them there for very long.
No, but even
3 days or so.
They other way. We must have your contribution.
Right.
They have that old image of the big colossus. Right. And the still, I'd be a very good middle of it.
Anyway, good night, sir. God bless you.
Thank you.
Really appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
How are you?
Fine.
Got a picture here.
All right. Now we've got a group picture.
Yes. This is Claude Titus, who's the executive vice president of the Wild Rice Association. Shirley.
Hello.
Harold.
Ryan.
How are you?
The Wild Rice is almost a specialty in Minnesota.
I know. I kind of like it myself.
Great.
Good to hear.
I'd like to make a presentation to you if I can, Mr. President. This is Minnesota Wild Rice, and I've honored it in here. And here is another one. There's recipe books in there. It's the only native grain in North America. And it is now, it is also the state grain in the state of Minnesota. So we're very happy to have it. Hopefully, maybe we can put it in the Playhouse kitchen to serve the dignitaries.
I heard you something about that, and I'm very pleased with the whole idea.
Wonderful.
Help with the food budget.
Yes.
Why don't you all gather around your own together? Kind of formalized group. Do a picture here.
They're going to send you 80 pounds, which is like a almost like gold. Keep this stuff, you know. It's very, very tasty. They're very hopeful that you use it in some of the state functions, because it's becoming a nice export.
We hope sometime to have some recipe ideas in other languages, so that if you have somebody, say, from Germany or wherever, that you can give them recipes in the German language, as an example.
It's called rice, but is it really any member of the rice family?
No, it really isn't. It's an aquatic grass, actually, and has very little similarity to rice. And of course, it's a native staple of our American Indian. Yep. And at this particular time, we have domesticated it, and we are doing paddy farming with wild rice, but the product is the same. As we gather in our lakes, still gather in our lakes in northern Minnesota.
Well, I got it. Thank you all very much.
President, I'd like to give you a wild rice recipe book, which is prepared by my wife and myself. And we have it for you and Nancy to enjoy.
Well, thank you.
Recipes in there. Someday maybe she'll have time to cook for you again. And I hope that you'll enjoy it.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
What's happening outside? Big
hill? Oh, that's goodbye for my beer.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. He's leaving. This is farewell to
him. Very nice. Very nice to be with you.
See you.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
It is a pleasure.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Great victory we had over there. I will work out the details.
All right.